example is like I would like to make a contract that contains the consumer price index so that I could in other contracts refer to that multiple and use it for monetary values of like paying salaries or something like that. And so a contract that stores information and then retrieves it later can be used by other contracts. But to give you an example of both of us interacting here, right now if I do get value, I'm told that the value being stored is zero. It gets initialized to zero to begin with. But let's say I want to change it to five. I actually have to interact with the blockchain at this point. So MetaMask prompts me and says, look, you're going to talk to this contract and you're going to do something. And I'm sending some data to the contract. So it's going to cost me a little bit of money up to a maximum of 1.7 US dollars. It'll probably be way less than that, but every little thing you do on a blockchain does take a very small amount of value to perform. And the reason for that is that if you didn't have every operation cost a little bit, someone could send spam to the blockchain and just like take over the resources without any cost of doing that, right? So now that I've set that value, why don't you click get value and see what you get?
I can get it. It's five.
It's five. So he's actually interacting with the blockchain and getting information back. It took me a couple hours to get to that point. So you're benefiting from the effort. But and I can change it to something else.
So in theory right now, if there were many of us that were connected, that we could have all hit get value and we would have all seen that it was...
Yeah.
That
yeah. Did you get the new one I put
I
in?
The new one, so
why don't you change it to something? One. Yeah. Why don't you change it?
Set it to 100.
Okay. And then I'm going to do a get, and it's 100. Yeah. Now one thing interesting here is you notice that when I change something, I have to pay some money, but when I'm just retrieving information from the blockchain, I don't. The get is free. So when you're because every computer on the network, on the blockchain, already has a copy of the entire state of the computer in it. So that's not an operation that costs. So you can imagine that if we were doing an ICO contract, what I would maybe want my webpage to do is display how many people had bought into the sale and like have maybe a progress bar showing if it's a cap sale, like how many more people can buy in before it's done. And so I may kind of present that side of it next week. But let's, with our last little chunk before we open up for questions, let's just look at the code a little bit because I think this is interesting. So here we go. Not simple. First contract. So... this is on purpose just a plain old HTML file. It's a single file that refers to some other JavaScript, but it's just basic HTML with a little bit of CSS. Here's where the JavaScript kicks in. We're using this library called FJS, and this thing here is to simulate the test RPC inside a browser, but we don't actually end up using it because MetaMask is sort of takes over. But FJS allows you to, it's kind of a standard for communicating with MetaMask or some other test RPC provider-like interface. What we have here is the bytecode of the contract. So I have previously written this contract, compiled it to bytecode. And a tool for doing that really fast I can show you is, here we are, Remix. It's just a web-based tool for that. And it will even, if you go to contract details, you see that it's converted this contract on the left that's written in Solidity, which is kind of like JavaScript, but adapted for blockchain purposes. It's compiled into bytecode. You could copy that bytecode straight out and just paste it as a huge long string into your code here. And then you have what's called an ABI, Application Binary Interface. And this is just talking about all the different inputs and outputs and storage that occurs for this contract to work. I've got some little stuff to hide and show during different elements of the page, but it's all just using plain old JavaScript for all of that. You see here that we have some event listeners that when you click those buttons like to set and get values, they actually take this instance of the contract that we've saved out, and they call a method on it, in this case get. And the get returns a promise, so you have to wait for the promise to return, and then it gives you the value from the contract. This thing is similar. It's a promise that tells you when the transaction is completed and gives you a hash for the transaction showing, you know, that you interacted with that blockchain. This routine here actually creates the contract. So if when I had that choice of like, do you want to create a new contract or do you want to connect to an existing contract? That piece is really what I modified this source code from. Before, the GitHub project that I forked from didn't have any way of connecting to an existing contract. So it was great for testing locally, but it wasn't great for an interactive session like we're doing here. So by adding that piece that allows you to either connect to an existing contract or create a new one, I could create it, but then he could connect to the one I had already created. And then the load existing contract is what gets called if you connect to a contract that's already on the blockchain. And there's just some initialization in here. But it's actually what's interesting about this part of it, and it's really just starting to take off, is that you can make a pretty decent little web interface. You can make it nice. You can use React or whatever framework you really like to use. And you can create an application that actually interacts with the blockchain in a user-friendly way. And so I think this is where anything more than so far all we've seen running on Ethereum are like ICOs, right? And they've been simple enough that people can just like generate a manual transaction, send some data. But even that is a little bit painful for non-tech-savvy people to do. And one could argue, I guess, that MetaMask and installing MetaMask is a little bit of a painful process. But once you've got it set up, the clicking around is really a user-friendly experience. And I think that for us to really get apps that run on blockchains, we're going to need to bridge that gap and make it so that you have really easy-to-use applications. So this is kind of where I think a lot of things are going. One great example of a project that's doing this is Aragon. And Aragon is building a UI, essentially a web interface for starting a company. And I wish I had a better, some better screenshots or something, but. Yeah? Do you know?
One that's really close is another one called Boardroom.
Oh, yeah?
Let me hurry in and put it on the
slide. But anyway, what Aragon's doing is like, when you start a company, you have like founders. Aragon is like a great app that, and there you can look for some YouTube videos where the creators of Aragon show you how it works. But like you can set your founders, you can say how much equity they get, you can say the terms of the equity, you can manage your whole cap table in here, and it's all based on a blockchain. And when you need to sign something or whatever or make a decision, it uses MetaMask for those kinds of things.
Is it slicing pie enabled?
I believe so. Yeah. It even has stuff like multipliers, like this guy gets this this vesting schedule, this guy gets this one. You know, it's, it gives you like so much configurability. It's really impressive. So anyway, that's a fun, cool app to look at.
Boardroom is another one, but it only does voting. It's all centered around creating proposals for voting.
So that's basically it for today. Is we've interacted with a real contract running on a real local blockchain, and can see how to integrate it into a web page. But does anyone have like questions or ideas or comments? Yeah.
Good question. So, so you created the contract, right? You're running a server on your machine, a local server that I connected to.
Yeah.
If your server went down right now, then my connection is invalid at that point, right?
That's right. Yeah.
And so, how does it work? Where, like, how do we make it so that you know you're not the central point of failure?
So this was really just for testing and development. We would never do this in a real life environment, and that's a really good segue into the way you would normally use MetaMask. So we're on a private network right now, but usually you're going to be on the main Ethereum network if you're actually interacting with a real live application. But there's also test networks that are out there for when you're kind of ready. You think your app is ready for prime time, but you want to just like try it out, and there are ways of getting test Ethereum to play with on these networks as well. There's a little bit of vetting to make sure that people aren't abusing the networks, but it's obviously a lot less than the, you know, having to buy real ETH on the live network.
So is there any way to take this example that you've shown us and make it so that you're not a single point of failure, or is it like
yeah. So if I chose one of these test networks and I had some currency on that network, I could just select it and I could do what I just did, upload the contract to it, and then it's running on a real live global network.
And so I guess I'm trying to understand how is it a global network? Like, is that that's just a different server on a different machine, or are there multiple servers?
Yeah, it's actually many computers all running a real blockchain.
So that's how it works. Everyone's running on their computer.
Yeah. And when I clicked like upload the contract or set the value, it would take longer to run. It would take like 30 seconds, up to 30 seconds to get a confirmation back that operation had completed.
And the way that MetaMask works is that it actually goes through a service called Infura. And Infura is a centralized access point to make it so that, because normally if you download something like Mist Wallet or something, you actually have to download the entire Ethereum blockchain run the node on your computer. Kind of like what he's doing, but it takes a lot longer to set up. But Infura is a product that somebody came out with, a company called Consensus, that basically gives you an API endpoint. Like the same way that you have that little custom one that allowed you to connect to his machine, they have their servers set up so that you can connect to their machines that will let you proxy like send transactions and stuff. It's not like as decentralized as we would like to be in the decentralized world. Like, if you were going to be a hardcore decentralized person, you would have your own server and you would do everything through that. But for like normal web developers, that's just like, I just want to connect to somebody else that's running an Ethereum node somewhere. Infura is set up to say, hey, we're running a node. Go ahead and connect with us, and we'll broadcast your transactions.
Yeah, another thing that you may have used before is my Ether wallet. A lot of people are storing their wallet on that, and when you send a transaction there, the nice thing about that is you don't have to download the whole blockchain because it's tied into someone who's already up to date on the blockchain. So you get kind of instant rewards for, you know, like, you don't have to wait. And my Ether wallet also has an array of a cluster of gateways that they use to manage all the transactions that my Ether wallet users are sending out to the blockchain. And they struggle when like an ICO is happening and everyone's trying to use it at once and stuff like that. So. Yeah, any other questions? Thanks. Next time, I'll try to bring a better networking solution. I mean, it's actually really cool that we even got it done as far as we did, but I would like to have this be like everyone's actually using it and seeing it. And next time I should have the actual ICO contract running, and so we should see, like, you know,
see people sending
people buying into the ICO and like watching the progress bar moving forward and stuff like that. So that's what I hope to have ready. So.
Yeah, it would be cool to get up on the test networks and get some of the test ether and
yeah.
distribute it out.
That'd be awesome.
That'd be really cool.
Yeah. So thanks a lot, guys.
So I'd like, if anybody has any questions, or Justin, I know, had a, if anybody, I don't know, sometimes people have little pitches of things that they're working on. Right now it's just kind of like free-for-all talk.
I'll go to lunch, but I don't want to bore anyone.
Well, this is kind of like whoever wants to hang out at this point and just chat about whatever is welcome to. So like,
Well, maybe this is it's actually the perfect forum. So, as mentioned, I work for the state government, looking at ways to